Good evening. Welcome to this regular meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. It is Monday, December 12, 2005. Prior to the Town Council meeting, we are going to have the swearing-in of the newly-elected school board members and town councilors. So we should have those folks stand down front, and the town clerk will administer the oath.
I, Cynthia A. Dill, I am the Swift K.L. I am the Swift K.L. I'm Linda J. Whitaker.
I, Linda J. Whitaker.
I, Catherine Ann Gray.
I, Catherine Ann Gray.
Do swear.
Do swear.
That I will support the Constitution.
That I will support the Constitution.
And will obey the laws.
And will obey the laws.
Of the United States.
Of the United States.
And the state of Maine.
And the state of Maine.
That I will.
That I will.
In all respects.
In all respects.
Observe the provisions.
Observe the provisions.
Of the council manager charter.
Of the council manager charter.
And ordinances.
And ordinances.
Of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
And statutes.
And statutes.
Of the state of Maine.
Of the state of Maine.
And will faithfully discharge.
And will faithfully discharge.
Duties of the office.
Duties of the office.
Of Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Of Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Of Cape Elizabeth School Board.
Of Cape Elizabeth School Board.
So help me God.
Oh, okay. I will. Okay. Thank you very much to the town clerk. And welcome to Councilor Dill. And on behalf of myself, I'd just like to thank everybody who voted for me, for electing me to another term. And now we will move on for the roll call by the town clerk.
Chairman Swift Kayada.
Here.
Councilor Backer.
Here.
Councilor Dill.
Here.
Councilor Fritz.
Here.
Councilor Lynch.
Present.
Councilor McKenney.
Here.
Councilor Moles.
Here.
Okay, and the manager.
Yep.
And the town clerk.
Here.
Okay, the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we have some minutes for the meeting held November 14th. Do I hear a motion?
I would move adoption of the minutes of the meeting of November 14th.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Are there any corrections or is there discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? It's unanimous, thank you. Reports and correspondence. Is there any counselor who would like to say something? Councilor Moles.
For those of you that were watching for last month or read the meeting minutes, I had mentioned last month that the Cumberland County Commissioners were going to have a meeting here in the chamber on December 1st. I had to make that announcement before I went away for a couple of weeks on a trip. And while I was away, they didn't get all their work done, so they weren't prepared to have that meeting and had to postpone it. But I was contacted by Commissioner Feeney, who represents South Portland, Cape Elizabeth, and Scarborough, who's asked that in the very near future we schedule a tri-town informative meeting to inform the community about what's going on with Cumberland County. So Again, sorry for those of you that were hoping to see us here on December 1st. We'll try and bring the county commissioners back in the near future.
Thank you very much. Any other reports? Okay, thank you. Town manager's report.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chairman. I wanted to make note that Harry Dean, who has been our transfer station attendant for almost 25 years, is going to be retiring. His last day is Christmas Eve. And Harry, I think it's one of those things that everyone knows him, but not a whole lot of people know his name. He's probably the municipal staff member who comes into more contact with citizens than any other staff member, with everyone visiting the transfer station, the Capel Recycling Center, just about every week. When Harry first started, we were, as Jack Roberts and others would remember, we had an open, it wasn't an open burning dump, but we were openly burning brush and demolition material. We had very, very limited recycling. There wasn't a swap shop, there wasn't a bottle shed, there weren't all those containers to put other things. And Harry has really been an instrumental part, working with Bob, working with the recycling committee, at advancing the great progress we've made. And I don't think it's any surprise in our citizen survey recently that we saw the very high marks that went to the Capel Recycling Center. We also, have seen that it written up in the Baltimore Sun. We've seen the DEP give awards as well. And Harry is a very large part of that success. He's very customer friendly and, just a real nice person to see. And there's a proclamation here the council's signing this evening that's going to be presented to Harry at an event that Public Works is having. And I know the council joins me in wishing Harry the best of retirement and really thanking him for all that he's done for the communities. He's a great person, and I know we wish him well. So thank you.
We do indeed. And on behalf of the citizens, I'd like to add the council's thanks to yours. Anything else in the town manager's report? Okay. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. We have two periods every meeting where citizens may come up to the podium here and speak if there is some topic that is not on the agenda that they would like to speak with the council about. So if you have something you would like to talk to us about, please come forward. Okay. No one is coming forward, so we will move on to item number one. It's the new council year. So this is the first item, and it is has to do with the election of a new town council chairman for the council year 2006. Do I hear a motion?
I make a motion that David J. Backer be elected to chair the council for year 2006.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
I would just like to say what a great job Dave has done over the last year as our Finance Committee Chair, and I'm sure he'll make a great Council Chairman.
Thank you, Mike.
Okay. I would like to add my thanks to David. He's been Finance Chair while I have been Chair, and he's done a wonderful job, and I expect that he will do a wonderful job as Chairman. So hearing no further discussion, all in favor? 7, none opposed. It's unanimous. Congratulations, Councillor Backer.
Thank you, Madam.
Okay.
Well, Anne, this last year of your tenure as council chair must have seemed like a lot longer than a year.
About like a year and a half.
Like about a year and a half. Because it was. Anne has presided over the longest council year perhaps ever. Because last November of 2004, the citizens of Cape Elizabeth voted to amend the town charter to move our municipal elections from May to November, which extended the current council year by 6 months. And no one was better suited to serve that extended term, so thank you for your willingness to do that. And the town is indeed fortunate, because it's not often that a town gets the benefit of a Harvard MBA for cheap. And the town has gotten and continues to get its money's worth, and more so.
I hope so, more so.
And a whole lot more from Ann. Nobody works harder to know the facts. Nobody does their homework more diligently. Nobody listens more patiently to all points of view than Ann does. So thank you for all of that.
You're welcome.
Ann took the reins as council chair from Mary Ann Lynch back in the summer of 2004, right when we were in the middle of the statewide debate over the Pulaski Tax Cap Initiative. And Ann ably, very ably, led us through the last few months of that debate and ultimately to the defeat of the initiative in November. Thank you for that. And she has presided over lots of accomplishments over the last year and a half. I did a quick review of minutes from the last tenure of yours, 18 months worth, and there is just an incredible list of things that we've done. And I just want to go through some of the highlights of what Ann has led us through. Negotiations with the Maine DEP, Department of Environmental Protection, to permit the town to construct the new Spurwink Bridge, which is part of the discussion tonight, in part, at Gullcrest, without having to grant the state an easement over the entire Gullcrest parcel, which was originally requested by DEP. The establishment of a cell tower overlay district on Bowery Beach Road. The change of municipal elections from May to November, which resulted in your extended term. An update of the town's policy regarding the undesignated fund balance. Just like the ghost of Christmas past, you know, coming to visit all these things.
My life is flashing before my eyes here.
A comprehensive review of all town-owned lots, adoption of a policy for the use of proceeds from the sale of town-owned property, the adoption of a land acquisition disposition policy, the constitution of a new comprehensive planning committee, approval of a $5.4 million sewer system rehabilitation plan, the establishment of a committee to study the future of the Spurwink Church, a consideration of a proposed easement over Fort Williams Park, the approval of an accord between the town and the recently formed Thomas Memorial Library Foundation, the approval of a new operating agreement with Eco Maine, the successor to Regional Waste System, amendments, lots of amendments to town ordinances, lots I know so well because I served on the ordinance committee after having been brought onto that ordinance committee by Mary Ann Lynch, who promised me that it was a committee that didn't do very much.
She lied.
We were waiting for you to get on, David.
Amendment of the zoning ordinance regarding open space and phased developments. Amendment of the traffic ordinance to permit the use of the so-called Denver boot on vehicles with unpaid traffic violations. Amendment of the zoning ordinance to reduce the front setback and permit earthwork operations in the BB district. Amendment of the zoning ordinance to permit multifamily use in the BA district, amendment of the sign ordinance, the overhaul of the coastal waters and harbors ordinance, and 100 other administrative policy decisions that have guided the town over the last 18 months. And on top of all that, during your tenure as council chair, you served on the executive committee of the Maine Municipal Association. I could have had no better mentor during my first 2 years on the council. So thank you for all of you have done. As council chair, you've made us all proud.
Thank you.
And thank you for serving.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I just want to say that David is very kind with this long list. He's making me tired just hearing it recited, but all those things were not may have been done while I was council chair, but they were not done alone by me.
I've worked with great fellow counselors, including Jack Roberts, who has just rotated off the council, and I want to thank the counselors, including David, who has been an able finance chair, who's really set my mind at ease about working with numbers, and the budget has been in very fine hands with him. I also want to thank the town manager, the town clerk, and the assistant manager for, and all the staff members, but those are the ones I work with, have worked with principally. And just want to thank them for all their help. They've kept me on the straight and narrow. But I especially want to thank the citizens for putting their confidence in me and for sharing their views with me, because citizen volunteers and citizen input is what makes this town work. So I thank you all. It's been a real pleasure, and I'll just got reelected, so I'll be here for another 3 years. So thank you again.
Thanks, Ann. Well, for my first evening as council chair, I forgot to bring my reading glasses, so Jack Roberts was kind enough to loan me his 1.75 cheaters. Thank you, Jack. I'll need them as we go through this. I thank my fellow counselors for their vote of confidence. I will do my best to continue to earn your confidence and trust. And I look forward and am honored by the opportunity to serve as chair. So thank you to all of you. And I look forward to working with our town manager, with the rest of town hall staff, with the department heads, with the school board, our school superintendent, with all of the citizens who volunteer on boards, committees, and commissions to make our town just the outstanding place that it is to live. So thank you to all of you. And Anne, take care of that chair down there. I've grown fond of being on the end, sort of out of the line of fire. And the best thing about sitting down there is that there is no place you will ever have an opportunity to say the Pledge of Allegiance where you will have a better view of the flag.
I'll keep that in mind.
So I'll miss that. So with that said, let's move on to the business of the evening.
David, I wonder if we could move items 2 through 11, just approval as set forth in our agenda.
I'd be happy to take those as a group.
And I could explain to the public, this is the appointment of the various committees and adoption of the town council rules.
Item 2 is adoption of town council rules. The rest are appointments of our finance committee, ordinance committee, appointments committee, representatives to RWS Board of Directors, appointment of representatives to the Greater Portland Council of Governments Executive Committee, appointment of representative and alternate to Greater Portland Council of Governments General Assembly, appointment of representative to PACS Policy Committee, appointment of representative to MMA Legislative Policy Committee, and appointment of representative to Thomas Memorial Library Foundation.
So I would move approval of items 2 through 11 as more fully set forth.
Second. Discussion?
Dave, should we first move to authorize voting them as a block and then do the vote for a procedural?
Procedurally, is that necessary? Should we?
It's
okay. May I have a motion?
Well, I would move that we take items 2 through 11 as a block.
Second.
Discussion on the motion to take items 2 through 11 as a block. All those in favor? 7 in favor? None opposed? Back to the motion itself, Councilor Lynch.
And the motion itself is to approve items 2 through item 11 as set out in our agenda, and in terms of the rules as more fully set out in our package.
Would you mind reading for the benefit of the public just who the names are that are associated with each position?
Sure, okay. For Finance Committee, it would be Councilor Paul McKenney as chair and the council as a whole. For the Ordinance Committee, Carol Fritz as chair, Cynthia Dill and Marianne Lynch as members. Appointments Committee, myself as chair, Michael Moles and Ann Swift-Kayada as members. For CAPES representative to the RWS Board of Directors, it would be Carol Fritz and Michael McGovern. To the Greater Portland Council of Governments Executive Committee, Paul McKenney. To the Greater Portland Council of Governments General Assembly, Michael Moles and Cynthia Dill. To the PACS Policy Committee, Michael McGovern. To the Maine Municipal Association Legislative Committee, Ann Swift-Kayada. And representative to the Thomas Memorial Library Foundation, David Backer.
Thank you. And we had a second from...
Actually, Paul had already seconded that.
Councilor McKenney.
So moved.
Discussion on the motion? Councilor Swift-Kayada?
On the town council rules, there were... I had spoken with the town manager this afternoon. There were a couple of changes, typos that I had suggested. And I didn't know, were we going to receive a fresh copy of these? We have it? Okay, I'm sorry. Never mind. We have it. Never mind. Thank you. I didn't receive a manila folder.
I didn't see a manila folder either.
It is in a manila folder. It's just that David and I are out of the loop.
So everybody got their manila folders except Councilor Swift-Kayada and I?
This gives you a lot of faith in the outgoing chair and the new chair, doesn't it?
Nobody has their folders.
Thank you. Could we just pause just for a moment, just so we can dig these out?
And can you tell us what the changes are that were suggested?
Well, I can tell you what I had suggested as changes. I understand that our chairman had made a few changes, but on the third page of the initial copy we had gotten, in section 13, there were some words that were repeated. I have the old version in front of me. It says the chairman shall preserve decorum and order, may speak to points of order in preference to other members, and shall decide all questions of order subject to an appeal to the council by motion regularly seconded. And then it should say, and no other business shall be in order until a question on appeal is decided. One of the lines had been repeated.
It's
just a typographical. So in the new version, that should be out. So that was what I had suggested. And then there was just the duplication of numbering in the rules. It seemed like a lot of the sections had section one, and then section two, and then A, A, B, B, and so on and so forth.
So I would just move then
the new
adoption
version
of the new version of the rules.
The changes were not really substantive in terms of meaning. They were just more typographical in nature.
Okay, well, thank you for the critical eye. I had actually noted just one small typo in the rules, as long as we're making a change and updating them. In section 8, which is on page 2, the last line of section 8 set refers to the affirmative vote of 4 members. There should be an S on member. That was all. So with those changes made and noted, the motion stands. Any other comments? All those in favor? The motion is approved. 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Which brings us to item number 12-2006, In by the Sea Annual Licenses. Could I have a motion, please? Councilor Moles.
Dave, I'd be happy to make a motion on behalf of the In by the Sea. Item 12-2006, this is a move that we approve their request for the annual malt, spirituous, and vinous license, along with a special amusement permit for dancing and entertainment, et cetera, as set forth in the agenda.
Second.
Second, Councilor Fritz. Comments, discussion on the motion?
I would say that the In by the Sea is a great member of the Cape Elizabeth community. Whenever there is a group that's doing a fundraiser or other community event going on, they have been very charitable and very giving to the community. And that is very much appreciated by all the residents of Cape Elizabeth.
And Susan Legg is here?
Is not here.
Is here.
She is here?
Yep, sitting back there.
Oh, she's hiding.
Ms. Legg, who is the applicant for this?
Me.
You individually? Okay. DBA?
Susan Legg.
Okay. Thank you. Other discussion? All those in favor? Motion is approved. 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Item number 13-2006, we have a request from the Nordic Ski, what are we calling this? The Nordic Ski Club, Cape Elizabeth Nordic Ski Club. Who would like to make the presentation on behalf of the club? If you would tell us your name and address, please.
My name is Hillary Egan.
I think the microphone will pick you up right there at the podium.
I don't have to touch it?
You don't need to touch it.
My name is Hillary Egan, and I have something I'd like to pass out. A piece of paper. I thought I'd hand them to Ann, and then they'd come this way.
Okay. Thank you.
I've passed out three things. The first is essentially the text of what I'm about to say in a letter form. The second is a small red booklet, which we hand out to interested families and parents and skiers who might be interested in Nordic skiing. And the third item is a copy of page 7 from the comprehensive plan for Gullcrest Trail development that was published in the year 2002. Good evening, councilors, and thank you for the 10 minutes that we have to present our request for trails for cross-country skiing in Cape Elizabeth. Many of the people here in the audience tonight are members of Cape Nordic. Cape Nordic is a local nonprofit. We call ourselves a booster club, I guess. You were looking for something to call us. And it began about 10 years ago. We're called Cape Nordic because Nordic skiing is the word that is used internationally to refer to what many people call cross-country skiing. This is the kind of skiing which does not require a chairlift or a mountain, but is enjoyed casually as a pleasant hour or a day in the woods or on a golf course or skiing around a field or, as relates to this particular request, on specially designated trails. Like most sports, there is also competitive Nordic ski racing offered for all ages and all levels of ability. Like a road race, Nordic ski races are a gathering point for people of all ages, and the day is spent engaged in a lifelong fitness activity in fellowship with other skiers and their families. A standard race will be 5 kilometers, and it might take a skier 15 minutes. Shorter distances are mapped out for shorter legs, and kids as young as 4 to 5 years old participate. Once the course is identified, then the snow is groomed either to be flat or groomed with the side-by-side double tracks. Then the skiers start in sequence, usually one at a time, and race against the clock. So this kind of racing serves to improve fitness and improve skier ability, and it's really fun. So the reason we're here today is to talk a little bit about the attributes of a good cross-country ski trail. One is that it's wide enough to get good snowfall from the sky. And secondly, that it's graded flat enough to groom the double track side by side so a skier can pass another skier. It's good if it has a mixture of terrain of small hills, gentle sort of sweeping corners, and that it avoids a puddling wetland condition. It's excellent if it hitches into other trails that provide loops of various distance. And it's designated as a non-motor vehicle trail to preserve the snow and the grooming. The same attributes for trails are desirable for walking, for biking, snowshoeing, cross-country running, and also improved accessibility for the general public. There are currently 85 families involved through the school with Cape Nordic, and there are other families in town who also Nordic ski. And it's this membership that compels our request to the leaders of the Town Council Trail Development Project to consider a trail design that can be useful to the many sporting constituents in our town, including Nordic skiers. I now would like to introduce a fellow member of the Cape Nordic Board. Dave Roberts is at the projector, and Muzzy Barton, our past president, who will speak specifically about some trails in Cape Elizabeth.
Yes, I'm Muzzy Barton. I'm a resident of Gordon's Lane in town. I am currently the head coach of the middle school cross-country ski team, Cape Nordic middle school team, and I'm also past president of the Cape Nordic Club. I also would just like to add that I'm also the proud father of four children that have gone through this program, two of my children of which are currently skiing on their competitive college Division I cross-country ski teams, and without Cape Nordic and everything that we've had going before, I know my kids wouldn't have had the great experience that they've had with Nordic skiing. We basically wanted to just get in a little more specific with some of the things that we were looking for. I wanted to call attention to the Town of Cape Elizabeth Gullcrest Master Plan, which was put together back in 2002. And in Section 6, and I know you don't have the benefit of the whole report there, but in Section 6, under Trail Construction and Design, in that master plan that was put together in 2002, there is the recommendation stipulation to put together cross-country ski trails, and I'll just read this very briefly. Some or all of the trails may be widened to 10 to 12 feet to accommodate competitive cross-country skiing. The trails that will be widened for cross-country skiing use will be designated at a future date with the approval of the Town Council. And that's really what we as an organization are looking for, is that next step to develop a trail. And we're really not looking, if you look at the master plan and you look at the layout of all the trails, there are numerous trails, as you can see on the slide here. We are really looking for a 2.5 kilometer loop that we could help develop, and actually a large portion of this trail that we're looking at has not yet been cleared. We've tried to highlight here the major portion of the trails that we are looking to perhaps gain ownership for and develop for cross-country skiing. Just very quickly to highlight what you're seeing there. If you're familiar with the Gullcrest area, one of the great advantages to this area is the relative proximity of Gullcrest to the high school campus, and actually to the whole school campus. And there are currently trails that actually allow access and actually skiing access to the Gullcrest Trails area that we're looking at. The area that's highlighted in the orange color is actually a trail that currently exists that runs up to the Goldcrest area, and actually with the new bridge that goes across the Spurwink River, the kids could actually leave the school campus, ski to the trail, and could use that for training or potentially for racing. One of the things that we find is difficult with our current Nordic program is that currently all our athletes go and train in Cumberland at the Twin Brooks complex, if you're familiar with that. And that entails getting the kids out of school on a school bus, busing them to Twin Brook, which typically in a school bus takes over half an hour. We get there, we train, we get back on the bus, we bring them all back. Dave Roberts did some research on the expense of sending those kids, both middle and high school teams, to Cumberland, to Twin Brook, and actually there's actually a cost of $88 to our program to bus those kids on each trip. And the middle school program, which I coach, makes two trips to Cumberland each week during the Nordic season, and the high school team travels up there at least that often, if not three times. So one of the advantages to having a trail locally would be to alleviate that time and expense of having to get the kids on the bus and get them up there. So that's really the basis of what we're looking at. I don't know if David can go back to the trail very briefly. The area that we're looking for is partially an existing trail, and partially it is an uncut trail. The portion in the dotted line on the extreme left-hand side, which would be the northwest portion of Goldcrest, if you can see it there, is an outer loop trail, and a portion of that trail has not yet been cut. It has been flagged off, and Cape Nordic as a club would be willing to provide the labor to cut that trail and help with design of that trail. And then if we were to have approval of this trail, we would like to take stewardship of that trail and maintain it. And then we would have an ongoing venue for practices as well as competitions. And the other point I'd just like to make is that our presentation is kind of coming from the Cape Nordic Booster Club side, but I feel that one of the most important aspects of this is the greater good of this trail for the whole community. We envision that this trail could be utilized for cross-country running as well as skiing, hiking, mountain biking, snowshoeing, basically the use of a trail, the non-motorized use of a trail, and we certainly see that would have huge benefits for the entire community. I don't know if David or Peter want to add any points or whether I've missed anything, but...
And I think we see this in Cumberland, where actually all the surrounding communities use that facility for skiing. And the other point I'd like to make is that it's not just competitive skiing. Having groomed trails makes it so much more enjoyable and easier for people new to the sport. And it's harder to get lost.
The other thing that I might mention that's so great about this entire area is that there certainly is great access to this area for the whole town, but there's also the availability of parking, so community members could come and park their vehicles and then utilize the trails. The other thing is the relative proximity of these trails to the athletic fields and the athletic complex, and one of the parameters of running a cross-country ski race is generally to have an open field area, which is typically in cross-country racing called a stadium, and the proximity of the athletic fields to our trail would enable us to have a stadium area to actually stage start and finish races. So that's another advantage to this trail.
It would really offer a venue to have a regional or state meet or conference, both cross-country running or skiing. I'd also like to introduce Cape Elizabeth's current president of the board, Peter Dunphy.
Hi, I'd just like to add one more point. Designating a trail for cross-country skiing would be as critical for the grammar school kids who don't get out of school early enough to be bused up to Twin Brooks and make it back in time. By the time they got up there, it would already be dark. So this location is critical to the grammar school kids because they can go right from school and ski and wouldn't have to be bused anywhere. Thank you. So simply tonight, tonight simply we're just looking for the designation of that 2.5K loop similar to what you saw on the screen there for cross-country skiing. And, you know, we're willing to work with the Conservation Commission and other groups using the trails, all right, and to help widen the trails or complete the proposed trails that are on there. The biggest section of trails to be completed there is part of what we've identified there along the top, the dotted line, and we have many volunteers that would be glad to help complete that trail as planned there.
I guess there's one error in this slide that I did want to point out. The lower part that, what's the name of that? By the D, that actually goes through a wetland, and it would, what we really had meant was that inner loop trail that's just to the left of it.
And we chose this trail, and there'd be many places where we'd have to work with for snowmobiles, for example, who use the lower portion there quite a bit. So there'd be overlap perhaps along the outside edge there where the athletic fields are so that they could connect up to the town farm property. And, you know, all those details could definitely be worked out. But we chose this loop mainly by process of elimination, whereas it would be the most suitable. And it isn't used as much, or portions of it, by the snowmobilers.
Yeah, it really is ideal because of the fact it has access from the school, it has the park and the athletic fields for the stadium, and it makes approximately a 2.5K loop, which would you know, allow two times around for a 5K race venue. Any questions?
I have a question. Did you work through with the town planner on this as well? Have you sat down and gone over that, the trail plan and all that?
We have, and I think Peter was at the last Conservation Committee meeting. I talked with Maureen today to see if we could address the committee tomorrow night. Not sure that we got on the agenda, though.
One of the things that strikes me is that you also, with this type of proposal, if the cross-country team uses the trails as well, you really created a much safer environment for training because it's off the road. I mean, anytime you drive through Cape Elizabeth when it's cross-country season, one of the big things you have to look out for are all these kids running up the road. So I think that's really neat that you're working with the other teams and thinking about year-round use here.
It's really a much healthier place to train as well, much lower impact on the trails. And, of course, that's the type of course that they race on.
Excellent. Really good work, by the way.
I think last year you did recognize the girls' high school team for winning the state Class B. It's, I think, the most successful program in the state of Maine. And program we can be proud of.
Hey, Dave? Would you mind killing the... Thank you.
You didn't need glasses before you needed them.
Yeah, I see this blue light in the middle of the page that I'm looking at.
Yeah, I just had a... there's snowmaking capability at Twinbrook, correct?
That's correct.
So during the seasons where there's not sufficient snowfall to ski on the trails as is naturally, would you then bus the school kids up to Twinbrook?
Right now, that is the plan, but that is one of the next goals that we have once we establish the trail system, is actually to try to provide for some snowmaking at Gull Crest.
Okay. My other question was, there was a mention that the trails could also be used by mountain bikers, and does that include the winter mountain bikers with the knobby tires, or?
No, that would probably tear up the trails.
Okay.
But I know that the Twin Brook facility is well used by people walking and snowshoeing, and I'm involved in the snowmaking there, and I'm just amazed, you know, at midnight or even 4 in the morning, you'll see people out on those trails either skiing or walking their dogs. It's very well used.
Thank you.
In a typical middle school or high school race, there are usually about 300 youth, so it's quite popular. And there must be, do you know how many families in the Bill Koch with younger children that participate? There's probably 7 or 8 at least.
In the town of Cape Elizabeth, yeah. Probably at least 10 families involved in the Bill Koch. The Bill Koch Youth Ski League is at a younger age.
The Bill Koch Youth Ski League is a group actually statewide and actually throughout the country which promotes Nordic skiing for younger kids, and it's for the most part kids from ages 5 to 13, and then typically kids of the older ages get involved with middle school or high school programs. But we do have quite a number of families in Cape Elizabeth that are involved with the Bill Koch Ski League and would certainly be utilizing this terrain as well.
Michael?
Mr. Chairman, it was mentioned that perhaps this could be referred to the Conservation Commission, which I think is important. It's something obviously to be very positive for the community. You know, in addition, and I'm not sure the Conservation Commission ought to be tasked with taking on the sole responsibility for this, it does involve quite a bit of coordination with other interested parties as well. There's the Conservation Commission, there's those with snowmobile interests, there's those with community garden interests. I noticed it. I think the trail goes right through the community garden as designed. There's also some wetland issues, there's bus issues, there's school department issues. And what I'd like to suggest is that, you know, that the Conservation Commission be a part of that, but that you really ask the staff to work over the next 2 months to report back at your February meeting, and in the meantime to meet with this group to get some more definition to their proposal, although I think they've done a good job, and to try to put all the pieces together so that perhaps as early as February you could have a more concrete proposal that you could consider that has involved a review in meetings with the Cape Nordic group, as well as all the other parties who are interested in the Gull Crest property.
Was it the expectation of Cape Nordic that these trails would be widened, groomed, and used this winter? Or is this something that you're starting now for a long-term plan for next winter?
Well, I would say long-term plan, but this is a good time to actually start work on it because the foliage is down and you can see, and I think it's a perfect time to plan the work.
But to start the planning as opposed to the actual skiing this winter? Yes?
Yes, though I think we might, maybe I should let the middle school coach address this, but I think there's plans to host both a middle school race this year in Cape Elizabeth as well as a Bill Koch race, and that might be a choice of venue if we could set it up on a portion of the trails that are existing.
I can speak very briefly to that. Last year in the middle school program, we were very anxious to try to have an on-campus
race for our middle schoolers, largely because we wanted to expose the community and particularly the kids at school to what a cross-country ski race was all about for the non-Cape Nordic people. So we actually did have a 2-kilometer sprint race on the campus, on the middle school campus, actually on the greater high school campus area as well, last March and early March, when we were fortunate to have all that ski, all that snow. And we probably will do that again, although it would certainly be better to have a race like that on a trail designed specifically for cross-country ski racing. So the hope would be that we could, you know, prepare, work towards the future of doing that. One thing that we have talked about as an organization at Cape Nordic is, with the great snow that we currently have and with the great hopes that we have that we'll continue to have snow this winter, we do have grooming equipment, and we do have a person in our club and in the community who will do grooming for us. And if we were to gain approval to, in fact, perhaps groom some of that field area up in the Goldcrest area, we would love to utilize that as early as this year. But I'm not sure that that's something that can be accommodated so quickly. But that is something we'd love to do as soon as, you know, next month or in February.
Just if I might, Mr. Chief, my suggestion has nothing against prohibiting anyone from doing grooming if they wish to do grooming in the meantime. That's fine. But I'm just concerned with beginning to develop trails before we've done the overlays of the wetlands and what's completely in conformance with our DEP permit. And, you know, part of the next 2 months is I'd want to look at that. But in the meantime, grooming or, you know, having events there, as long as they go through the school approval process if they're interscholastic, you know, that's fine, and we would work with the school department without it needing coming back to the council. That's already a permitted use on the property anyway.
Councilor Lynch.
David, first of all, I want to say I think it's a great idea. I'm a Nordic skier, but I'm mindful of David's earlier comment when he was talking about the things that were accomplished in the last year. And one of the things that took a long time was getting the DEP approval for just some of the walking trails. So I think it's important that we do it right. I think directing the staff to work with Cape Nordic, whatever snowmobile clubs are out there, other interested parties, and reporting back in February, given where we are now and the holidays, the end of the year, would be pretty timely to moving this along. So I think that makes a lot of sense, keeps things on the ball. And it sounds all very doable, but I know the DEP gave us a lot of agita last year on walking trails, and I'd just like to make sure we had all our I's dotted and our T's crossed, and including talking to the other groups in town. So I think that's a great idea, and I think February, what's our February meeting? Anyone know what that date is?
Second Monday, whatever.
Second Monday in February would be ambitious, but I think that it could be done if everyone is committed to coming together with a plan. So I'd like to see us go that route.
Councilor Fritz, did you have a question or comment?
Well, I did want to say that I really think promoting winter sports and getting the kids out and being active is a really good goal. I'm glad that Manager McGovern suggested, you know, all the issues and putting them together. I mean, I wouldn't be prepared to approve something tonight at all, because I know there are some issues out there. I am concerned about, you know, like how much, say, woods or trail. I don't know if there's any woods that you're intending. I can't quite visualize it on the map. But I'm also thinking about the long-term commitment and what kinds of equipment that you do need, and whether there'd be any, you know, I would not like to see any cost to the town. I'm not sure how, I mean, bringing 300 or so people, I've heard numbers like 500 at the competitions, that would certainly be an issue. I think we'd have to deal with. I don't know if people could be at the school parking lot and at Gulf Crest. You know, I do think there are a lot of issues, and particularly snowmobiles, and I don't know, trails that I know Jack Roberts has maintained, and so I just think bringing all those issues back in a comprehensive package makes a lot of sense.
Councilor Moles.
I just wanted to mention that I'm a big fan of cross-country skiing, or Nordic, as you like to say, and as you said earlier, it's the kind of activity that brings a family together. When I used to live in Millinocket, we were quite a ways away from the nearest downhill ski area, so myself, my wife, and all four of our children used to go cross-country skiing in an area that the town provided. It was actually a big boost to the town to have that area for its residents and for people from away visiting to go and cross-country ski and exercise. So I think this is great. And from my understanding, according to the town manager, they, at least for the interim, have some permission to do some limited grooming and preparation for what they need to do this winter. Is that correct, Mr. Manager?
Yeah, just not cutting of new trails, and that's where I was trying to draw the line.
Councilor Swift-Kayata.
I think it's a really interesting idea. I would urge, however, that we follow the manager's recommendation to make sure everyone who has an interest in this property has an opportunity to speak to this proposal. There are a lot of different users who use that property in many different ways, and I didn't even know there was winter mountain biking, but there may be a constituency for winter mountain biking. I know there's there are people in town in snowmobile groups who have been very active in putting together and maintaining a lot of trails out there, and it was unclear to me from the picture on the wall how much of this would be new trail and how much of it is existing trail, and I just feel a need for, you know, I'm sort of a data hog, so I feel a need for more information to make sure that everyone in town who has an interest in this publicly used property gets a chance to weigh in on it. So I make a motion to take the manager's recommendation that we send this idea to staff and have them check in with all the interested parties. I would like to hear the Conservation Commission's input on it, and just loop together everybody and work with the group together in a collaborative fashion. I think it's got a very exciting potential, but I just want to make sure there are no unintended consequences. So we can turn that into language of a motion.
Can I amend that to have it be clear that the staff will report back at the February meeting?
Yes, I would accept that friendly amendment. And I do have one point of clarification. I do have one question for clarification of the manager. Talking about grooming, that grooming would be okay now. Is that on certain trails or certain places? I'm concerned that we aren't just boxing out current uses. I don't want to just say nothing has changed in terms of who can use the trails or who can't use the trails at this point.
Grooming doesn't box out any use, and you know, if there's concerns of, you know, that the snowmobilers and the Nordic skiers have, you know, issues even with that, that can be worked out very informally.
Okay, fine. I just wanted to clarify that. Thank you.
In fact, I noticed that the nascent leader of this snowmobile association sitting next to one of the representatives of this group.
It's that collaborative nature of Cape Elizabeth citizens.
Small town. So it's been moved and seconded.
Discussion on the motion?
I just want to make one comment, and that is that I think you guys have done an outstanding job. It's very impressive. Mm-hmm. I was fortunate enough to hear your daughter and son give a presentation, and boy, what an impressive group of kids, and you've done just such a great job. I think once the details are worked out, you will easily support this, without a doubt.
And it is nice to see Mr. Roberts of snowmobile and Mr. Roberts of Nordic ski, brothers separated at birth, rejoined again and sitting next to each other.
Shall we move to questions?
So, all those in favor of the motion as presented? The motion is approved, 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Thank you to the Nordic Ski Club, to Cape Nordic. Hillary, thank you. Muzzy, thank you. Dave, thank you. Peter, thank you very much for your presentation. I think it's got the potential to be a fabulous amenity, a winter amenity, or even year-round amenity, but particularly a winter amenity for Cape Elizabeth. So thank you for the energy.
Thank you. If I might for a second. Just to the council, one of the things that wasn't in your manila folder but was at your place is you did get an email tonight at 6:30 from a Dr. Tom
McInerney.
Whatever. About this topic.
And what did Dr. Tom say? Oh, it's not.
Item 14-2006, a report from our appointments committee.
I thought, Michael, you might want to do it since
okay.
it's the culmination of your year as chair.
All right, bear with me a moment while we get to that. Well, first of all, let me thank again the other members of the Appointments Committee, Mary Ann Lynch and Carol Fritz, for this past year. It's always a tough job filling boards and commissions when you have so many fantastic volunteers stepping forward for those limited seats on our boards and commissions. We were able to fill some of the positions last month, and since that time, we have finished, we feel, filling the rest of the positions. Before I get into that, may I mention that in the coming year, we have a new member of the board, which would be Ann Swift Kayada, is joining us as Carol Fritz goes off to do another committee. And this coming year, Mary Ann Lynch will be the chairman of the Appointments Committee and will be running the meeting in January to familiarize all the boards and commissions with their duties. And I look forward to supporting both of them in that. For Board of Assessment Review, would you like these as a one big motion or in individual pieces?
How about one big motion?
I would move that we appoint John P. McEnough to replace David Scheffler on the Board of Assessment Review. For the Community Services Advisory Commission, I would move that we appoint Bruce Abramson, replacing Robert Chatfield. And I would move that we appoint William Marshall, replacing Colleen Graves. I will mention that tomorrow night, the school committee will be making one of the appointments per our agreement with the school committee for their member on the Community Services Advisory Commission. I would also move that we appoint George Schumann to the Recycling Committee, replacing Peter Ingraham. And I would like to also move that we place Rachel Stamiskin on the Recycling Committee. And for Zoning Board of Appeals, I would like to move that we place Peter Black on the Zoning Board of Appeals, Robert Chatfield on the Zoning Board of Appeals, and Gib Mendelson returning for an additional term on the Zoning Board of Appeals.
And I would second that motion.
Thank you. Discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all those in favor? The motion is approved, 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Thank you, Councilor Moles, and thank you to all of the volunteers and our boards and commissions. It's in looking through the resumes that came with this packet, it never ceases to amaze me that the talent we have in Cape Elizabeth, we have experts in Cape Elizabeth on every conceivable issue. And I mean, the more we can draw out those people to participate, the more the whole town benefits. So thanks to everybody. Next item on our agenda is item 15-2006, Winnick Woods Master Plan. The town council held a workshop prior to this evening's meeting. And do I have a motion to schedule a public hearing on the Winnick Woods Master Plan?
I'll move that we schedule a public hearing for January 12th to 30th.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Any discussion?
I would just like to mention for those that weren't here for the workshop, what a tremendous job the Conservation Commission is doing looking at this issue. Part of the issue was looking at a piece of property that Ms. Larea had given to the town and then named Winnick for her family name. But more specifically, we're looking at the possibility of dedicating a portion of the Winnick Woods for the New England cottontail habitat. And I think that's, you know, one of the most exciting parts of that plan. So for those of you out there that are inclined to come down to the public hearing, I encourage you to do so and give us your comments on this.
Thank you. Other comments? All those in favor of the motion to schedule a public hearing for January 12, 2006? The motion is approved, 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Next item on our agenda is item 16-2006, a DEP modification request. Mr. McGovern, would you like to comment on this?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. As everyone is aware, and as you mentioned in your comments about some of the achievements during the leadership period of Answorth Kayata, we do have an extensive sewer rehab project going on this coming summer that not only involves sewer rehab, but also road reconstruction. Part of the area that's being reconstructed is Running Tide Road, which is at the very end of Broad Cove, and also a small portion of Winding Way, which is a little cut-through street. I hate to use that term, but it's a nice street from between Hunts Point Road and Running Tide Road. I think, as everyone is aware who lives in that area, the town was able to obtain a right-of-way and actually ownership of a place called Jordan Farm Road, which extends from Two Lights Road into the intersection of Running Tide Road and Winding Way. If you bring vehicles to the intersection point of Winding Way and Running Tide Road, you could buy 91 homes that are mostly fairly close to the road if you come in the Broad Cove Way. If you come in the Two Lights Way and the Jordan Farm Road, it's 25 homes, including beginning with the St. Bartholomew's Rectory, extending down Two Lights Road and in Jordan Way. We previously received a modification of a permit during early construction project, and the reason being is to reduce the impact in the neighborhood of construction traffic, and also because the citizens, particularly along Broad Cove Road, were very concerned. I do want to allay any concerns that it is our intent to have this open, you know, for all traffic during the construction period. And what I'd really like to do is have the council approve this with three conditions. One, and not the DEP request, I'd like the DEP request to go as is, but in addition to the DEP request, the council could also place restrictions. And the three restrictions I'd like to see the council place is that it be one for construction vehicles, that it's not for general public use. Two, that it only be for the use of individuals on Running Tide Road, Winding Way, and Maysdale Terrace, when Winding Way, which is the connector road, is not passable, which would only be a few days during the whole project, that would be really virtually unpassable. And three, that during all the construction period, that it be available for emergency vehicles. You know, beyond that, we would have signage that indicates construction vehicles only, and we would work with the local police to do that. But I do want to allay any concerns or fears that we're looking at opening it for a six-month period and having people get used to it, and that there's some larger plan, as I'd love to see, but I realize it's not in the cards. But I would like the council to see that possibly with those three conditions in place, so that would allay concerns that there's a larger agenda here.
The second condition was that it be for individuals on Running Tide, Jordan Farm Road,
Running Tide, Maysfield Terrace, which is off Running Tide, and Winding Way during such times, limited times, that Winding Way is not passable.
Are we saying then that if you live on Salt Spray or Broad Cove during those times, we're not...
Only if needed to get to those streets. It's for the, there's no reason otherwise. Salt Spray is going to go out the other way anyway. It's the point being that we don't want this to be established as a big cut-through, and that the only, that for the most part, traffic, even from those streets, will need to go out through the regular way in Broad Cove, except when Winding Way is under active heavy construction. Not when it's just, you know, the normal construction, active heavy construction, you know, the backhoes and everything else in the middle of the street actively doing work.
And what about on the weekends when there is no construction going on?
That's a given. You want to add that as a fourth condition, that's fine as well.
That it would not be open on the weekends?
Not open on weekends except for emergency vehicles. That's always open for emergency vehicles anyway. I just want to be clear that it's always open.
What's the period?
We can make it be open. We have chainsaws and slippers.
How long a construction time period do you anticipate?
I defer that to the Public Works Director, if it's good enough to come.
Please.
We're still working out the details of the project, but I think we're looking at a 60 to 90-day project window for the reconstruction.
I'm sorry, did you say 60 to 90 days?
That's correct.
Thank you.
With that background, could I have a motion? Councilor Swift-Kayada?
I'd like to move that we authorize the manager to make application, or the town to make application to Maine DEP to permit temporary use of Jordan Farm Road during the 2006 sewer construction project with the four restrictions laid out as detailed by the manager.
If I might, I wanted to be clear that my proposal was those to be local restrictions and not to be part of the DEP permit, because I don't want the DEP to be getting involved in enforcement of that on a day-to-day basis.
I will amend my motion to make it clear that those are only local Cape Elizabeth restrictions, and the DEP has nothing to do with those.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Discussion? All those in favor? Motion is approved. 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Next item is 17-2006, Little League Lions Field dugout request. I see Mr. Thibodeau here. Would you like to step up to the podium? Step up to the plate and take a fastball. Low one outside.
Good evening, everyone. My colleague Dan Sullivan is just passing out a package of some information for you all. We're here tonight to get the town's approval to allow us to get some permits to put in some new dugouts at Old Lions Field. The Old Lions dugouts, if you're all familiar with them, are the green painted dugouts to the left as you're going up the access road. And they're about 15, 20 years old. They are in pretty sorry shape, frankly. Both cinder block construction, it's fraying away. There's standing water inside the dugouts. They're actually not of the existing, they're not of Little League International specs. These dugouts are 5x17, Little League specs are 6x20. And when you get 12 or 14 youngsters in there, it gets pretty cramped to the point where, frankly, they're not in there between the standing water and they're being smaller than regulation. They come out and they get out on the field, and frankly, it creates a bit of a safety issue from my perspective. We have probably about, of the 550 kids that usually play Little League every year, probably 300 of them, 350 use that field during the season. So it gets a lot of usage and a lot of traffic. What we'd like to do is actually, as I noted, to make the dugouts a little bigger, 6 by 20, and also actually move them down the baseline, again, in compliance with the Little League regs, which would be page 3 on the handout. It shows where those would, actually page 4, I'm sorry, will give a better idea as to where those will be. So we're moving them further down the baselines toward home plate on either side, and we're making them a little bigger. We've included some pictures in your handout of the dugouts as well, including a picture, I guess, of Dan, of your little, one of your little boys. And then the last page is a picture of what they do at South Portland National. We're considering that as the possible, kind of the prototype. It's obviously much bigger, as you can see, a little more area, and we feel the kids will stay in the dugouts, which is really, the point of going through this. That's really all I guess, have to add at this point. I certainly take questions. And
questions for Mr. Thibodeau?
Councilor Lynch. Just one. The Little League would be responsible for all costs associated with?
At present, that's what we're assuming. We're hoping to get some contributions from various organizations, and I've actually started to reach out to some for that. But we're assuming we've got to foot the bill.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions?
Do we need to make this a motion to give them permission to approach the planning board?
I think we need a motion.
Well, then I'll make a motion to authorize the Cape Elizabeth Little League to request permission of the planning board for the permits and approvals necessary to replace the dugouts at Lions Field.
Well, is it Little League, or the way the agenda is set up, it's that the Little League is requesting permission to have the town apply to the planning board?
So who pays for the permits?
I assume that's part of the cost that the Little League would.
When the town applies for permit, the permit fees are waived. It's the town policy that dates back to when we had some roofing issues at the schools many years ago, that the town is responsible for plans going to the board and for representing the town before the board, so that the assurances that are made are ones that can be kept.
And are there, if I may, Mr. Chair, are there costs to the town for putting together plans, or is the Little League proposing that they will cover those costs?
I haven't heard the position of the Little League on that issue.
Well, let me ask the first part of the question then. Are there costs to the town?
Yes, there are.
And what would those costs be?
I would guess in the $1,000 range, including, the wetlands and the plants. Might be a little bit less, but probably in that range.
And my final question, sir. So is it your proposal that the Little League would be paying those permit costs? I'm just trying to figure out who's going to pay those costs. Is that part of your proposal?
I can certainly make it part of our proposal. I frankly hadn't even thought about the cost of the permitting. If we need to add it, we'll add it.
Is that the usual protocol, to have the town reimbursed by whatever group is benefiting?
It has not been, but to be honest, we've run into problems with the town going and then the money not being raised, and then wear out the permitting expense and nothing happens. It hasn't happened with the Little League, but it has happened with some other groups in town.
I
have a question. If the dugouts were refurbished but not moved, would there still be the need for all the permitting?
Where the permitting comes in is the enlargement of the dugouts from the current size and the movement of them because of wetland setback issues, as well as the creation of additional impervious surface. When we create, if they simply put the dugouts where they are now, rebuilt them of the same footprint, there would be no requirement for any permits to the planning board.
Is there money I'm sorry.
No, go ahead, Councilor Lynch.
Is there money in the budget for the town to do this? I mean, it strikes me that if they're paying, the Little League is paying for all the construction, but the town is the property owner, and we're talking about $1,000 that will benefit 500 kids in town. Is there a way that we can find $1,000 in the budget? I know we didn't budget for it, but is our budget so tight that we don't have $1,000, or can we find $1,000?
Through you, Mr. Chairman. You know, there's never an extra $1,000 in the municipal budget. I think the council's well aware of that. But, you know, fortunately, the council also has been very reasonable when June comes along, or May or June, in looking at all the different areas. And if there are areas where we're a little bit overspent because of some unforeseen things happens, the council deals with that. This is not a budget breaker. You know, it's, you know, by June comes, we may not have spent $1,000 somewhere else. The our professional services accounts are running on the heavier side right now. But $1,000 is in, you know, a budget of $30 million, if you look at the entire picture, is not a whole lot of money.
Okay.
Councilor Fritz.
I mean, one of the expensive things, I would think, would be drawing up maps for the planning board. I don't know if this map, I mean, it already has contours on it. You know, I don't know if these are adequate. Planning board.
There's so many copies of plans, so many copies of sheets, and there's, you know, sending someone out to field verify the information. You know, there's been other projects where we've gone to the engineer, and I'm trying to remember what was the one recently. We said we wanted a real low estimate on it, and they remember which one that one was, Bob? Yeah. Yeah, there was another minor one. And, you know, we work with them, and they understand we want a little work done, not a whole lot of work done. But we do, you know, we understand we need to meet the planning board requirements just as any other applicant does.
Councilor McKinney.
I would like to say that what the Little League is proposing improves the town, makes it a better place to live, helps the kids, benefits the community. And I think the least we can do is follow our established practice of supporting the organization by taking care of the permitting process.
I made the original motion, but apparently I got a few words wrong when I made it, so let me clarify and amend what I had said there so we can hopefully get a second and then officially discuss the motion. So my motion, to clarify it, is that the town apply to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board on behalf of the Little League for the permits and approvals necessary to replace the dugouts at Lions Field. And I would further amend that motion that the town pay for the cost of acquiring those permits.
I would second your motion.
Motion has been made and seconded. Discussion on the motion. Councilor Swift-Kayada.
I'm fully prepared to support this motion and to have the town pick up the $1,000 or whatever it is. Because I think it's for a good cause. Councillor McKinney makes a good point. It's for the benefit of many children in Cape Elizabeth. However, I would caution the council. Perhaps it's my ornery veteran status here, but I have participated in a number of council discussions over the past years where $1,000 has been a real sticking point. And it may not be a sticking point now, but when it comes to deciding on things at year-end, carry forward balances on you know, a few thousand dollars for fireworks or a few thousand dollars for library improvements or a few thousand dollars for whatever, I have seen us have some real tussles over $1,000 here. So I expect that most of us, or if not all of us, will support this, but I just want us all to remember this, because I'll remember it when we have discussions with the manager about why he's $1,000 over on this or that, or legal services or professional services or permits or whatever. I really think we have to just be aware that $1,000 here, $1,000 there, and we're talking $30 million before we know it. So, but I am prepared to support it. I think it's a good idea, and I don't mind the town paying for it, but I want us to remember this conversation.
Councilor Moles.
I agree, and I would further mention there was some discussion about, you know, there have been some groups in the past that have had the town set up permissions and then not followed through with the fundraising. However, I think we've seen with the Little League, especially with their new work over at Playstead Park, that they have the ability to raise funds and see a project through to completion quite successfully. So they, you know, they come in and here well recommended.
Other comments? Well, my only comment is there's nothing extravagant about this. From the photographs of these dugouts, it's amazing that the Board of Health didn't condemn these long ago and forbid kids from entering them. It's long overdue to bring these up to snuff. So, all those in favor of the motion? Motion is approved. 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Mr. Thibodeau, thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
This last time you were before us, you got a no. This time it's a yes. You're batting 500. You know, people have gotten into the Hall of Fame with lower batting averages. Next agenda item is 18-2006, acceptance of gifts. Does this require any introduction?
I want to thank Deborah Lane for putting together the list, and I know going you and thanking all the citizens and others for their donations.
Councilor Swift-Kayada.
I'd like to make a motion to accept, to gratefully accept this list of town of gifts and donations to the town for 2005.
Second. I'd like a second. Councilor Moles. Discussion on the motion? All those in favor? Motion is approved. 7 in favor, 0 opposed. And I join the manager and Councilor Swift-Kayada, as I'm sure the entire council, in thanking all the people who have been so generous in making gifts to the town. Next, do we have a series here that we can take as a group?
19 through 29.
I would move that we take items 19 through 29 on the agenda as a group.
Do I have a second?
I'd like to set aside item 29 because there was nothing in our package on that.
That's fine. So I'll amend my motion to accept to vote items 19 through 28 as a group when we vote.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Discussion on the motion. This is a motion to take them as a group.
Oh, sorry.
Okay, all those in favor? Motion is approved. 7 in favor.
6-1.
1 opposed. The motion carries. We will take them as a group. Now a motion to approve.
Explain it first.
Could you explain it?
Yeah.
Since I'm not sure how they all fit together.
Yeah, let me try to put this. I think in every instance, this is the second time that each of these issues have come to the town council. When they were up to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board between preliminary approval and final approval, these all came to the town council for conditional acceptance, saying that they were built according to the plan, that they would be accepted. All of these drainage easements were part of the Planning Board approved subdivisions. All of the open space provisions were also part of the Planning Board approved subdivisions. There's several new roads involved in this. One is Autumn Tides, which is off Wells Road across from Layton Farm, part of the old Layton Farm. Second is over Hamlin Street and Dermot Court, which is off Stevenson Street, which is off Spurwick Avenue, right on the curb by South Portland. There's also an item number 29A, which we'll just council vote on later, a small section of Stevenson Street as well that extends from Spurwing down to the intersection with Hamlin. In addition, in the Grover Acres area, is the extension of Grover Road, that as you go down Grover Road, it now hangs a right and curls back up the other way. There are letters in your manila folder from the town engineer indicating that all of these roads were built according to the plans. There's one point that he does make in the 1-4, one of the pavements not on yet.
Hamlin Street.
The Director of Public Works really doesn't like the final paving put on a road until there's been a year's worth of activity, so a lot of the houses go in and some of the other issues. In the case of Hamlin, the final paving isn't on, but as the engineer points out, we are still holding the money, the letter of credit, that is more than enough that we'll pay for the final paving. So my position and the town engineer's position, the Director of Public Works, is that all of these are in line to be approved this evening. And I will make note that a couple of them jumped the gun, you might notice, and have already filed them in the registry prior to town acceptance, and we will caution folks again that they shouldn't file them in the registry until the council actually votes to accept them.
Can we get a motion first before discussion?
I would move acceptance of all the items 19 through 28 as set forward in the agenda for acceptance of roads and drainage easements, et cetera.
I will second that motion.
Discussion on the motion, Councilor Fritz.
I guess my objection to these is kind of a process question. My memory fails me as to when they came to us before, and I have no way of being able to evaluate these. I couldn't go out and see them. I couldn't see where the open space is that's proposed, because we have no maps, nothing to visualize any of this. And I think a similar thing came once before when we were to accept open space.
And it turned out to be wet.
With no maps. Yeah. And I just feel this is, every one of these is incomplete information. And I'd like it to come back to us at the next council meeting with it, so I can go out and look at the road and see whether we want to accept it or not, or whether, and I want to know where that open space is exactly.
Councilor Swift-Kayata.
I'm prepared to accept these, to vote to accept these. However, I would request that the manager or the planner or whoever has put these together next time, I too would find it very helpful to have a map of it. And I am prepared to support this, but I think it would be much better because I was trying to figure out where these were and I was very unclear on what we were talking about. So for future similar requests, I would ask that we could do that, please.
Councilor Moles.
And I would like to ditto those remarks that I trust in the town manager and what he's said about these particular properties being up to snuff with the town engineer in the future, especially when we have a legal description in here of the open space. I would like to see a map of what the open space looks like in the future, because there was one occasion when someone brought forward an open space to us that was a non-usable marsh, not even a highly rated marsh, that they were just taking off the town, off their tax rolls, taking them off the town tax rolls and giving them to the town. And I think we tried to send the message to the planning board that, hey, stop accepting, you know, useless wetlands, you know, as open space.
Is there any harm in delaying for another month so that we actually have the information?
Yes. There is on the drainage easements and on the all of the road acceptances, because they are very desirous of relieving themselves the responsibility of plowing and transferring that to the town.
So could we separate out, say, the items and approve the drainage easements and leave the open space issues.
Councilor Lynch.
I would hate to see us wait a month in light of the snow and the plowing issue. Like Ann, I would just ask, and I think, Carol, you make a very good point, we should be able to visualize it on the face of the earth. So I plan to vote on this tonight, but you do make a good point, and I'll echo Ann and just say we need to have a better picture.
The thing is, if I might, I think we said that last time, and the information didn't come this time. So if, you know, I...
Michael.
I was going to say, we will require from this point on all of the applicants for street acceptances and open space gifts as part of the development to supply copies of the page on the site plan at the regular planning board scale that shows all of these open space requirements, not only at the time of final acceptance, but also at the time of conditional acceptance. You won't get a whole set of plans, but you'll get the sheet that includes all of these in both instances.
And the open space here is 1.01 acres.
For the autumn tides, yes.
Is it, and?
You want to explain what it is?
Is that the only open space that's being given to us? That it looks like it is.
Yes, it is.
Can you describe that piece to us?
Yes. As you look at Ralph Layton's old farm, for those of you that have been in Cape Elizabeth for quite a while, if you go up on Wells Road, you get Billy Jordan's farm on the right, his farmhouse. On the left, you get Billy's farm. You reach the end of Billy's farm, there's a new house that was built there that Ralph Layton's son built, which is just beyond Billy's farm. You then have a brand new road that extends to the left down by the marsh. That is Autumn Tides Road. As you look at Autumn Tides Road, if the portion, most of the open space in this instance is the portion closest to Wells Road. It was felt by the planning board that it was better to create a feeling of openness to keep the land closer to Wells Road as the open space. There's also a narrow path that goes all the way down to the marsh as well, so that there's pedestrian access from the road down to the marsh. But in this case, the bulk of the acreage is the part that's closest to Wells Road, so that the lots are significantly set back from Wells Road, the remaining building lots.
So it's a 1 acre lot right on Wells Road?
It's right on Wells Road with a sliver that goes down to the marsh.
Other comments? Councilor Moles.
I've driven by that. Now I understand where that site is, and I think the planning board was wise to set it up that way, because it does give a more open feel to that area, as opposed to crowding the houses up against Wells Road, which would have blocked the view of the marsh. I think they did a good job there in this instance. And I again, am prepared to vote in favor of this evening.
I would move the question.
All those in favor of the motion? Opposed? The motion passes, 6 in favor. Councilor Fritz opposed. Which brings us to item 29-2006, and in our folders, we have the material for items 28 and 29, which is the acceptance of a portion of Stevenson Street. Yes, it appears to be an Ost Associates letter.
Yeah, but the key, 28 and 29 just describes the acceptance of the different streets. The deed is the one that says short form quitclaim deed. Item number 29 is part of that Ost package that was in your manila folder.
I'm sorry, I'm lost.
Your manila folder.
Yes.
You've got three or four Ost letters that say that this dated December 9th.
Yes.
That indicate the road should be accepted. And then on item 29, you also have the deed now.
Found it.
29. Yeah. What happened with this one is, when the deed came into my office last week and I looked at it, it it indicated that we were accepting all of Stevens, all of the Cloutier's interests in Stevenson Street and in Hamlin Street that were part of the subdivision and that were not part of the subdivision. The concern was that Stevenson Street does not end at Hamlin Street. It extends down to South Street, which is a dirt road, which is unimproved. And some of you may remember a number of years ago, there was a gentleman who lives at the last house on the left on Columbus Road, approached the town and said, this is a accepted public way. You need to construct the last 20 feet of this public way. And there was a big stone. It was obvious they stopped it back in the 70s or whenever it was done, 60s, because there was a big stone rock there. Well, he pushed the point. We checked with legal counsel and found we had to go to the expense of taking out all that rock and building the road up to the where it was shown on the plan. So we won, when we got this one, Stevenson Street, it almost looked like it was dealing with that same liability. So at that point, I called Michael Hill, the town attorney on these land use matters, and said, Michael, this deed doesn't work for me. Explained why. He called Jim Cloutier, James Cloutier, some of you may know, was the attorney for Cloutier Construction. And he said, fine, we'll revise the quitclaim deed. And the quitclaim deed now provides that it extends the portion of Stevenson Street only extends down to the edge of the right edge of Hamlin Street, the correct edge. So we're not accepting the balance of Stevenson Street, which would have been a liability. So that's the reason why you didn't get this deed with the other deeds, because it was not the original deed that was submitted was not acceptable in my view to for the staff to recommend to you that it be accepted. This deed, I would recommend that you accept.
Councilor Knowles.
So what you're saying is you're not just another pretty face. You actually look at these things when they come across your desk.
I have to admit, I don't study all the deeds. I generally rely, but there was some reason this neighborhood's always been confusing. I took the time to read all the deeds.
Well, I thank you for reading the deed and clarifying that for us. I'm going to defer to Mary Ann, though, who wanted to.
I was just going to make a motion that we accept the deed.
We have a second.
Second.
Discussion on the motion? All those in favor? Motion is approved. 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Item 30-2006, amendments to the personnel code. Deborah, Ms. Lane, our assistant town manager.
Good evening.
Good evening.
From time to time, we come to the council with changes or amendments to the personnel code. The changes that we have before you, many of which are housekeeping items, the changes actually were prompted to a recent change in the Maine Human Rights Act, prohibiting discrimination in certain instances for sexual orientation. So you'll see the first change in section 3-1-1 in the Equal Employment Opportunity section. We are recommending that the language be added: physical or mental disability, status as a whistleblower, veteran status, sexual orientation. Upon reviewing several different personnel codes from various municipalities, the state, and so forth, the disability, whistleblower, and veteran status were often used in terminology in the equal employment opportunity, so we thought this would be an opportunity for us to add this language as well with the sexual orientation. The next section, 3-1-15, payroll deductions. This is really a housekeeping item. For a number of years, we had limited, if you will, payroll deductions for employees to choose from two credit unions. The reason why we did that is before technology, we actually had to cut checks for deductions, and also the town was charged a fee. Now with technology, payroll deductions, as well as direct deposit, are all done electronically and no fee to the town. So again, this is just going to give the employees an opportunity to have their payroll deductions going to a financial institute of their choice. The next section, workplace violence, section 3-1-19, is actually an addition to the personnel code. What we're proposing is to add language that addresses workplace violence and harassment. Currently, we have the sexual harassment section of the code, and again, looking at other codes and talking to other human resource folks in the area, this is one section that a lot of municipalities have added, and I believe it's in the state code as well. Earlier today, Chairman Backer had some wordsmithing in this, and I believe, Chairman Backer, it was in the second to last sentence where it begins, the town will strive to maintain a safe, healthy atmosphere that allows employees to perform their duties free from conduct. There was a which, and you had requested that change to conduct that can be considered illegal harassment. Am I correct on that?
In part.
And then there was another section in there?
Any properly reported complaints, yes.
Okay. Considered illegal harassment or acts of violence?
You're right. Just adding the words properly reported.
Properly reported.
Any.
Okay. The next section is leave of absence, which is section...
Excuse me. While we're on this section, could I just ask a question? So it's going to read perform their duties free from conduct, comma, that can be considered illegal harassment, comma?
The comma should come out so okay. That it says from conduct that can be considered illegal harassment, again, comma gone,
or acts
of violence.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure. Okay, thank you.
If I may also ask a question, the second sentence of section 3-1-19, the town will not tolerate illegal harassment or acts of violence of its employees? Shouldn't it be either against or by?
Or both.
And
that's a good point.
Either against or by is pretty different consequence. I mean, you can't.
So you're saying it should be tolerate illegal harassment of or acts of violence by its employees?
Yeah, the question though, if it does, I don't know if I have the answer, but the question is whether it's, we're not tolerating violence against employees or violence by employees. Does the victim have a right to enforce the policy, or does the town have the right to enforce the policy against an employee who commits an act of violence that has no repercussion to the town?
It should be by.
Do you follow me?
I think it should be by.
Wouldn't it be by or against?
That would help.
I would put both of them in. Because we're not going to tolerate harassment or acts of violence by our employees or harassment or acts of violence against our employees.
Why don't you take out the of its employees?
I think the word of needs to be replaced by, but in addressing Ann's comment against, this applies only to town employees, et cetera, not to the general public that might harass town employees. That would be followed under a separate code.
Mr. Chairman, I would suggest when there is a motion to adopt this that you exclude that paragraph and we bring it back next month. I just want to be sure that the language that we have is the one that is statutorily correct, that I think the attempt here was to follow the statute, and I'd be careful of rewriting the language, you know, sitting here this evening. So when, you know, if everything else is okay in this, I'd suggest that you adopt this ordinance, and we'll revisit this paragraph next month with to make sure that we have the correct language statutorily.
Okay.
Councilor Fritz.
Well, we're making some corrections in the articles as they're listed, you know, the first thing, the listing of them, there's two 3-1-17s and it doesn't actually include this added one, workplace violence. So
right, that first page of the code, absolutely. I mean, depending on where the page ends when the final draft, I wanted to make sure that all the page numbers and everything coincide. So that will all be corrected when you get your final version.
Smoking policy needs to be 18, and then...
That, again, the paging is different now that it's on my system.
We'll correct all the references automatically.
Yeah, once the final's done.
The table of contents isn't adopted as part, but it's a reference.
As long as your flow has already been interrupted. I was going to wait until you were done. But could we go back to 3-1-1? In the your introduction suggested that it was important to add veteran status, but I don't see any reference in the new language to veteran status.
Right. It should say, and I should have emphasized that, physical or mental disability status as a whistleblower, veteran status, sexual orientation, or any other non-merit factor.
What? I have a question.
Councilor Dill.
I've never seen veteran status as a protected status in a human rights or equal employment opportunity. I know veteran, I'm not advocating the discrimination against veterans, but I've just never seen that category of people included as a protected status. So I'm just curious, although other towns and municipalities have it, I'm just wondering if there may be an ordinance where those municipalities are that include veterans. But I don't think under the Maine Human Rights Act or Title VII or any other discrimination statutes that I'm aware of, veteran status as a protected class. I just would want some clarification on that.
We can check, because this is exactly in the paragraph where I received them from other communities. So I was, we were just trying to follow what was correct. So we can check on that for next month as well. Yeah.
Was there a comment down here? No.
No.
Councilor Swift-Kayada.
So I just want to make sure I understand. So where are we on the veterans issue?
That'll be brought back next month.
That'll be brought back next month. Okay, thank you.
So we're not being asked to approve 3-1-1 with veteran status?
If you're more comfortable leaving that section out, that's probably best.
I would prefer that you adopt it and then, as written here, and then we bring back next month whether or not we need to add veterans. I think it's important, particularly after the November vote, that we deal with.
But so it's not in here.
That's it's not in the. Looking. Yeah, you adopt it as written is what I'm suggesting.
Okay.
And we'll bring the veterans group.
Councilor Knowles, and then we'll let Deborah Lane finish.
I can wait.
Okay, Deborah.
Section, in Article 2, Section 3-2-6, talking about leave of absence. And currently, if someone takes family leave under FMLA, they may potentially have up to 12 weeks in a calendar year. So they could actually take up to 12 weeks in calendar year 2005, and then potentially take up to 12 weeks at the beginning of calendar 2006. Which potentially would give them 24 weeks uninterrupted leave. We want to change that and actually clarify that it would be up to 12 weeks in a given year. Chairman Backer has provided some language different than what was in your packet, that the sentence would state, no more than 12 weeks of unpaid family leave shall be permitted in any rolling 12-month period.
Rolling from the date of the first leave?
In any rolling 12-month period.
Okay.
Okay. The next section under 13-2-10, employee health benefits. Currently, the Public Works contract that went into effect July 1 provides for effective July 1, 2007, the town shall pay 90% of the cost of the premium with those with single coverage. This language would also provide for the non-union, so it would be in the personnel code, that provision for essentially single coverage employees paying 10%, and again, the municipality paying 90. It would remain the same that the town pays 80% and employee 20% for dependent coverage. That section would not be proposed to be changed. And the other, under section one, the 125 plan, again, this is housekeeping in terms of the Maine School Management Association now oversees the section 125, and also there's a proposal to increase the reimbursement limit from $2,000 to $3,000 per year. The dependent care reimbursement limits of $5,000 per calendar year per family, that would remain the same. There's no proposed changes on that because that actually is the limit according to IRS, so we would not be able to increase that.
Can you tell us all what the Section 125 plan is?
That is an opportunity for employees to put aside up to $2,000 per calendar year to be used for medical reimbursement and that type of thing. It is not taxed.
Pre-tax basis.
I believe at the end of the year, if you do not use it, you lose it, if you will. So folks are very carefully in trying to plan their deduction for the year. And again, this change would increase their ability, if they wish to have up to $3,000 per year taken out for that plan.
People have used it for hearing aids, for eyeglasses, for the deductibles, for their prescription, their co-pays on their prescriptions.
Yeah. Councilor Lynch.
I wanted to go back to the employee health benefit copay issue, which we just rode through at 90 miles an hour, and it's a big change. But I don't know if anyone else wanted to comment on the 125, and we finish that up, and then we go back to the copay.
I just had a question on the 125 and why we take it back. I thought it would go into a fund that
it's the law.
It would accumulate.
Isn't the law?
Federal law is that on December 31 of each year, actually it's a little later than that because they have time to submit bills, that you either use it or lose it. That's IRS regulation.
Okay. And that's all employee dollars?
That's section 125. That's what it reads.
There's a new proposal in Congress that they're looking at health savings accounts that will roll from year to year, but that hasn't been put into law yet. But if it does, that's a good thing for the employees because they won't be penalized for not using it in a given year.
At RWS, we had been talking about section 125 for the employees, and I guess I knew there were tax savings for the town, but I really didn't come across that it was gone at the end of the year.
It is.
Yeah, use it or lose it.
Councilor Lynch, do you want to go back to the?
Section 3-2-10, the copay. I've long been an advocate of a copay, and so I don't want to pour cold water on this issue, but I also want to make sure that we are not preempting or viewed in any way as preempting our budget discussions next February or March. So while I support this, I think it's important to recognize that the copay, as a result of budget discussions next spring, for non-union employees could be something other than 10%. So it's the only thing I want to say is I would hope that any vote tonight would not be viewed as something that preempts us from doing what we may or may not have to do. And I'm not suggesting that there's any plans to do anything, but this is something that has historically come up as we look at the budget in January, February, March. And it just I think it's great that it's here, but it strikes me as a little bit unusual that we've got a rather big change coming up with little or no discussion. And that's all I want to say about it.
Yeah, as has been pointed out, the We have two unions in town, and then for the municipal employees and the balance of the employees are non-union. The Teamsters Local 340 has agreed to this provision effective July 1 of 2007. The police, Maine Association of Police, have not agreed to this and have indicated very strongly they will not agree to it. You know, it's a big step for me as the town manager to put forward something for the non-union employees to have to pay without treating them on an equal basis with the union employees. And while we still don't have the police having agreed to this yet, you know, we've worked with the Personnel Advisory Committee made up of representatives from all departments. We've also discussed it at that meeting in the presence of the police union, making clear that it does not apply to them. You know, while I understand Councilor Lynch perfectly in terms of the council does reserve the right, you know, people do watch these meetings, and, you know, I do want to make clear that it will be my position, you know, in the budget and beyond, that we not go any further to the non-union employees than we have already gone with the union employees, you know, within that same time frame. I'm really pleased, you know, as a single employee myself, I will admit that for the first time I will be contributing to my health insurance. And, you know, maybe we'd like more, but we've looked at the standards of you know, what the public sector does and what our competing communities do, and this is right on target with that. And but I understand your right to revisit it, but I do want you to know that you shouldn't be surprised during the budget session that I won't want to go any further than this goes.
Councilor Lynch.
Okay. Normally when we make statements about something being right on target and doing right in line with other towns, we also have that data in front of us. And we don't have that data in front of us tonight. So that's again why I just want to make sure, at least speaking for myself, that this is not something that preempts us from looking at what other towns do and looking at it fresh in the budget in the spring. And I'll just say that to make the record clear as far as my views go. But I will support this tonight.
Okay, we still don't have, we don't have a formal motion yet. Are you prepared to make a motion?
Well, let me comment on that before I say the other comment I wanted to make. My comment on the motion is, I would like to see each of these things taken individually and discussed again individually, because I'm not prepared to vote for some of these tonight. I'm not prepared to vote in favor of some of these things tonight, and especially the one that Mary Ann was just talking about. I don't think we've discussed that enough, and whereas it doesn't take effect until July 1, on that particular item, maybe the town manager could explain to me why we have to vote on that tonight as opposed to, you know, discussing it either through workshop or the budget process and bringing that item back in a month or two. You know, maybe he can tell me why. I mean, I'm amenable to his explanation.
Just to clarify, it's July 1, 2007, not 2006.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's no immediate need. It's just a matter of, you know, I think we have the non-union employees acclimated to the idea that it's coming. We've had extensive discussions with them over the last 5 months, 6 months, since the Teamsters contract's been approved. And other than the police association, while a lot of the single employees aren't exactly thrilled with this, they understand that the time for a contribution is here, and you know, it's, you know, perhaps here now, but July 1, 2007 brings it on the same time schedule as Teamsters and Public Works. There's no immediate need to do it. It's just that, you know, I just hate to have it brought up, and you know, it's tough enough to bring employees along in understanding the significant cost of health insurance, and I think they're ready to accept the vote at this time. And, you know, I worry that as things evolve that we could have a gap of understanding, and we have they aren't exactly thrilled with it. I think we have a good acceptance of it at this point in terms of understanding that it is the way to do things.
Councilor Moles, would you be willing to make a motion?
Well, I want to discuss that and the other item that I actually raised my hand to discuss originally, and then we can move to the motions.
Well, so, the item that he's talking about, when we, if we take these one at a time by motion, would seem to be a good time to talk about the town manager's comments when we get to the issue of the deductible.
All right, so why don't I make a motion?
For the copay.
All right.
So maybe we can start with 3-1-1?
Yes. For the purposes of discussion, I would move that we make the change in our personnel code, Article 1, Section 3-1, employment, to read as read here, to come into conformity with the Maine Human Rights Act, including that we prohibit discrimination against any person in employment, housing, public accommodations, credit, and education on account of sexual orientation. In addition to that, including whistleblower and veteran status.
I think we had
disability, whistleblower, and veteran status.
Agreed to leave out veteran status and simply change it to read to add a prohibition against discrimination based on physical or mental disability, status as a whistleblower, and sexual orientation.
Well, I understood that we did say that a few minutes ago. However, I'm not prepared to abandon the veteran status at this moment, so I'm looking for a second to my motion.
I'll second your motion.
Now we can discuss.
Thank you. Discussion on the motion. Councilor Swift-Kayada.
Could you repeat the motion, please? I want to make sure I understand what's in and what's out.
My motion was to include everything in that's in the paragraph before us.
Well, the two ways, the physical or mental, adding the physical or mental disability, the status as a whistleblower, sexual orientation, and then also adding, even though it's not in the text we have before us, but then also adding disability, I'm sorry, adding veteran status.
Correct.
Well, if I may continue to comment, I would prefer to leave, I've got no problem with the veteran thing, but I would prefer to leave it as we said before, where it would just come back, approve the language as it is now, and then bring the veteran thing back and add it next month. Or you know what? Strike that comment. Strike that comment. I take that back. Strike that comment.
I'm all for veterans. I'm married to a veteran. My stepson is active duty in the Marine Corps right now. But I'm listening to what Cynthia Dill said about protected status. And I would not be prepared tonight to add veteran to it. I think were we to do so, we will be left with everyone in town, every employee is protected status except white males under the age of 40 who are not veterans. And I think everyone else would have a protected status. So at this point, I don't see why we would add veteran absent a showing of some problem. And I guess I'd like to know that there's an issue in state law. We're changing this to conform to state law. We're changing this because of the recent referendum. And I think that that's important that we do that. But I don't think we should be expanding the protected classes beyond those that are generally protected. And I say it with the utmost respect for veterans. I want to be very clear about that.
Councilor Dill.
Yes, and in fact, I think by clarifying it, we're actually helping veterans because there's nothing worse than having a town ordinance that's in conflict with a state statute when you're trying to figure out who's rights, who has rights and who doesn't, and how to enforce those rights. So I think it's in everyone's interest, including the veterans, to have some clarity whether or not the town ordinance is going to mirror the state statute or not.
Councilor Moles.
how can you protect all those other groups and not protect veterans? And you can say that you, you know, support veterans, but I think the best way to really show you support our veterans is to just leave that language in there, as other towns have left that language in there.
It's not in there.
And that's
now.
Why it was brought to us.
It's not. Other discussion on this item so we can move along? Councilor McKinney?
Maybe I should speak because I am a veteran. And three of my kids are in the military. I don't know where you got the language, but I'm assuming you got it from some reliable source. You certainly didn't make it up.
I did not make it up, but I mean, just with a conversation, I really think that we should revisit that.
I don't have a real problem with it. I just think that right now, I find that when I go somewhere in uniform, I get respect. There was a time in this country not too long ago where that wasn't the case. And I presume that in the future there will be another time that that may be true again. And that's why the whole veterans protection came out in the first place, and that's why they get some extra points for federal civil service and so forth, because it's recognized that sometimes that discrimination does exist. And if this war continues and it gets less popular, oftentimes the blame doesn't go to the politicians that enact the legislation and put the military at risk. It goes to the people that have to perform the duty. And that's the only concern I would have. I'm not worried about myself and my future employment, but I think that sometimes it doesn't go the way it is today, the way people feel about veterans. So I wouldn't have a problem revisiting it, per se. But I think we need to be careful of what we do protect and what we don't.
I think this is an interesting discussion. I was particularly interested to hear Councilor Dill's comments, because when I read this for the first time, I had never seen a reference to veteran status as a protected class. And to be honest, I didn't read it the way any of you are reading it, and I wondered whether the protection intended to be vested here was people who are discriminated against by an employer because they didn't serve in the military. If an employer has two prospective employees in front of him or her, one was a veteran and one isn't, and the employer says, I'm going to hire the veteran. Thank you for serving. And the person who has been discriminated against based on veteran status is the person who didn't serve.
You know, that's a great point.
So I really don't know what this means. And I guess I would like to follow our assistant town manager's lead in deferring this until we can figure out what the purpose of it is and where it came from.
Do you think we can get that brought back for next month, where that language came from?
That's what we have been talking about.
Okay.
To do next month. Yeah, you'll have it next month.
Because I was thinking in a different way, that maybe a veteran goes off to service and would get their job back. I would think, and
there's a federal protection for that.
Yes.
It's, you know, that is very serious. Mm-hmm. A lot of these guys coming back have lost their position.
Mm-hmm. So I would like to explore.
That's right.
Councilor Swift-Kayada.
I, having heard everybody's discussion here, I'm very doubtful that we understand what is meant by this reference. Potential reference to a veteran, because we don't know if it means, as you said, somebody who is a veteran or who isn't a veteran. So I would ask that if we do defer the veteran discussion to the next meeting, that we not only find out where the language came from, but we get some sort of interpretation as to what it exactly means, because I don't think any of us, we don't all have the same understanding of it. So I will not be supporting Councillor Moles's.
Well, I would accept that as a friendly amendment.
I'll second that.
So the motion as amended is to approve the suggested language change without the addition of veteran status as a protected class.
And that will bring it back next month with some more information on where that came from and what it means.
I've heard all the comments tonight, and we'll report back to you.
And do we have a second to the amended motion?
Second.
So moved.
Further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? The motion is approved for the change to Section 3-1-1.
For the purpose of discussion, I'd like to make a further motion that we approve the change in Section 3-1-15 under payroll deductions. The town is no longer, well, as the language set forth in there regarding payroll checks.
Second.
Discussion on this motion?
Yes. I have a question. This is what I raised my hand for about 20 minutes
okay,
ago.
Okay, go ahead.
Do people still get a pay stub so yes. they can track things?
If they have direct deposit, yes.
Okay.
Not everyone's required to have direct deposit. We encourage it, but not everyone has it. But yes, we still get a receipt.
Yes. Further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Is that a hand
that
up?
That was a yes.
Motion is approved, 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Do we have a motion on 3-1-19, workplace violence?
We would prefer there be no motion on that, which means it not be approved at this point.
So we will skip over 3-1-19, move on to 3-2-6, leave of absence.
I would move that we make the change in the personnel code to clarify that the leave may be taken within a rolling 12-month period.
Could you read the specific sentence for that, Deborah?
Be happy to. No more than 12 weeks of unpaid family leave shall be permitted in any rolling 12-month period.
We have a second for that motion?
Second.
Discussion on the motion.
I'd like to discuss that motion. I'm opposed to this motion. I don't see the need for this change. If someone's legitimately ill in a calendar year, if they're ill in July and they needed those 12 weeks off, they go through a period of recovery and then they need an additional 12 weeks off the following spring, that would follow more than 12 weeks in the calendar year. I don't know why we're even thinking of making this change, what the purpose of it would be. I see no serious need to put this additional stress on the town's employees by making this change.
Councilor Dill.
Yes, I also don't see the need for the change, only because if you look in paragraph B, one of the requirements I know under the FMLA is that the 12 weeks in order for to be approved, the employee would have had to have worked the 1,250 hours of service during the 12-month period preceding the request for leave. So that sort of takes care of this trying to calendar it out. The only way they're eligible for 12 weeks is if they've worked in the previous 12 months 1,250 hours. So you don't, that's already a check in the process of whether or not they're qualified for the leave in the first place.
So that's 30 weeks or so?
The reason for this proposal is that we did have an instance of an employee who deliberately scheduled an event to enable them to have 12 weeks leave in two successive years. And it was our belief that that was not the original intent when this language was adopted. So we have had a specific instance of a planned vacancy that took advantage of this, and the employee who you know is who it involved is well aware that we're proposing this change and is accepting of it.
Councilor Swift-Kayada.
So a plant meaning 12 weeks at the end of 1 year and then connected to,
yes.
not a separate incidence, but
yeah.
so 24 weeks in a row.
Exactly. Okay. That's what we're trying to avoid.
Councilor Mullins.
I don't think this is the place to address that kind of an issue. If the employee had a serious health issue which required 24 weeks of recovery and they used 12 weeks in 1 year and 12 weeks in the next, then so be it. Do all of our employees do that? No. But if someone had a legitimate health issue which required that long of a recovery period, I'm sure they went through enough pain and suffering through whatever procedure they had to have, you know, whatever it might be, that, you know, if that's been our policy when we hired them and that's been our longstanding policy, 12 weeks per year, I don't see the need to change it at this time.
I'd love to respond, but I don't want to go into the individual details of an individual employee's medical decisions. There's a reason we propose this, and I think everyone's accepting of it amongst the Personnel Advisory Committee. They all understand the reasons, and the employees are accepting of this restriction on their ability to take time.
Councilor Dill.
I just had a question. Do Cape Elizabeth Town employees have short-term disability insurance?
We do. We have an income protection plan, and those that are in the deferred compensation plan that aren't the leftover in the retirement system also have an LTD plan. And we also have an LTD plan, those that are the remainers in the retirement system, that is offered through the Main State Retirement System. We also have Social Security disability for all of the employees as well, and there's offsets based on that.
Thank you. And my comments earlier weren't necessarily that I was opposed to the proposed change, just that it seemed, again, to maybe present a conflict with interpreting the proposed paragraph with paragraph 3-2-6B. But
Councilor Lynch.
What the manager and the town management has proposed is very common in the private sector, the rolling 12-month approach. And I think it is because while everyone wants to provide leaves, when you have a small organization, when people leave for 12 weeks, 24 weeks, you put a burden on the remaining employees. The town has functions that it has to carry out. There's a balance to be struck. I think that what the town manager has proposed is a reasonable balance, and I would defer to the manager in this particular case because he has to make sure that we are staffed to do all the things that we are required to do as a town. So I think it's a reasonable balance between personal, as in NAL requirements of individual employees, and the personnel NEL requirements that we need to make to run the town for the benefit of the people who live here.
Last comment?
No. And I would counter propose that it's easier for the town to plan for someone that's going to be gone for 24 weeks in a row than it is for someone that's going to be gone 12 weeks, back for a month, and gone for another 12 weeks. I really, again, am opposed to this change at this time. If the manager wants to bring it back to us at a later date executive session or in a workshop and discuss it further, my mind could be changed with more information. But with the information I have in front of me, I'm not in favor of making this change tonight. And yes, that was my last comment.
Thank you.
We do have a motion, right?
I made a motion.
Do we have a motion and a second on this?
Let's move the question.
All those in favor of the motion?
And the motion, I'm sorry, just for clarification, is to approve the language as it's set forth in section 3-2-6?
No.
Actually, it's slightly modified to a rolling 12-month period. Would you like our assistant town manager to read the amended language once again?
Yes, please.
Would you, Deborah, please?
I would. No more than 12 weeks of unpaid family leave shall be permitted in any rolling 12-month period.
I think, may I make a comment?
Well, we've had a call for the question, so if we can go ahead and...
But does he have a question? So, motion?
It relates to this, and I think what Councilor Dill is pointing out is that she's, it's redundant, it's, they're at cross purposes. She's saying that it's already in the language, and we're proposing language that isn't necessary because on page 314, under family leave, it already states that somebody has to work 1,250 hours before they're eligible for another 12 weeks. Is that what you're...
I don't read it that way.
Well, as a point of order, when there's been a request to call the previous question, I guess it's the chair's position to ask if the question should be put, in which case there is a vote without discussion. So, the matter before us now is a vote, yes or no, as to whether or not we should vote on the original question or whether we should continue to debate. So, all those in favor of the request to...
Call
the question?
Call the question means we can debate further?
No, it means that we will cut off debate and vote up or down.
Takes a two-thirds vote to call the question.
Oh.
It was Councilor Swift-Kayata's motion to call the question.
Can I ask for clarification? I'm sorry, I don't...
And the...
What you're doing.
We're voting whether to vote.
The request is to cut off debate and vote on the motion.
Okay. So you want to proceed and vote on the motion? That's the...
We're voting on whether or not to cut off debate at this point on the underlying motion.
And move the question. And then move the question.
So, all those, again, in favor of supporting Councilor Swift-Kayata's motion to cut off debate and vote on the underlying motion. Okay. The question is called. We're now voting on the underlying motion, which is to approve the new proposed language. All those in favor? Four in favor, opposed? Three opposed, the motion carries 4-3. That was procedurally torturous.
Welcome to your first night as council chair.
Now, if we can move on to 3-2-10, employee health benefits.
I would move the adoption of a 10% copay for the single premium coverage effective July 1, 2007. But I also stipulate that could be subject to change in the budget process.
Do we have a second?
So moved.
Discussion on the motion.
I would say that, as we discussed earlier, we have a budget process coming up. This doesn't go into effect until July 1 of 2007. I see no need to vote on this particular change tonight. We could handle this through our regular budgetary process, which begins next month. Again, I see no need to vote this in tonight. My other concern is that without the data in front of us, you know, here we are, we're not looking at what the union employees are making compared to the non-union employees to see whether it is a fair assumption that the non-union employees are at par salary-wise with the union employees. We might be asking them to give up something that when they're at a substantial shortage compared to the union employees who may or may not have the ability to give up a little bit more towards their payroll. I don't think we have the data in front of us tonight to vote on this and then have to readdress it through the budget process. I would prefer that we address this particular issue through the budget process when we have all the facts and figures in front of us. As much as I do truly trust the town manager means well and is trying to run things in the town's best interest, I would like to make that decision when the data is in front of us.
Further discussion? Councilor McKinney.
I'd like to ask the town manager to comment on this, please, if you could, Michael.
I think I already commented on it fairly extensively. I don't, particularly the lateness of the hour, I don't want to repeat myself too much. I think the, you know, Councilor Moles asked for some information on pay data. You know, we look at pay issues, we look at benefit issues. We do look at all those things and will during the budget process as well. The other than that is the looking, I think, a thing Mary Ann had mentioned earlier about comparable communities. We did look at this, and I think, I don't remember the exact number, but the average, I believe, was 89%, 11%, where amongst the comparable communities we look at. In this case, it's 90-10 that's being proposed.
Okay, that's what I was looking for. And therefore, I would be willing to support this. We can always bring it back up. What we're trying to do, it seems to me, is put things in line so that non-union and union employees have a similar situation.
Further discussion? Councilor Fritz.
I guess I would like to see some wording in there that says maybe what you said, that they be comparable or that they pay a portion, but that it, the number not be in. And I'm not sure I can do the word on that. Just to take out the 10% and maybe wording that says non-union and union be similar, or that gives us the flexibility to change it.
Well, I think we always have the flexibility to be able to change it, but I think that if we're going to adopt anything, it has to be specific as to whatever it is at the time.
I might say, personnel code is amendable at any time by the town council.
Councilor Swift-Kayada.
I'll be supporting the motion. I am confident in the manager's comments that the town employees are mentally prepared and perhaps not enthusiastic, but understand that the trend in employee benefits is this way, and I think it is a good thing to have the union and non-union employees on a sort of similar type of basis, so I'll be supporting it.
Further comments? Hearing none. All those in favor? 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Last item on the personnel code, section 125 plans, which is also 3-2-10, 3-2-10B.
Move we adopt that as part of the personnel code.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion? All those in favor? The motion is approved, 7 in favor, 0 opposed. Well, that was easy.
You did a good job.
31-2006, PACS reallocation, Mr. Town Manager.
Mr. Chairman, you know, it took Ann a year and a half to figure out I didn't like to be called Mr. Town Manager. So.
Mr. McGovern, Michael.
Thank you. Anyway, PACS is the Metropolitan Planning Organization for Greater Portland. They are the controller of federal and state funds to a certain point. What we're finding is that PACS can propose and MDOT can dispose. We've had a number of projects that PACS has approved and that have gone to MDOT, and MDOT says, we won't approve this because if the road isn't totally, we dealt with it on Fowler Road a year ago and now we're dealing with this. If the road isn't built totally to federal specifications, we will no longer allow any money to be spent on it. The challenge the Cape Elizabeth has is to build our roads to federal specifications, we don't qualify for any federal funds because in the PACS point system, you only get credit if you have a lot of traffic. So we've been playing the game of trying to put in inexpensive projects that might have the cost benefit yield because the expensive projects get absolutely nowhere. We were able to get funding originally for a project on Shore Road and a project on on Sawyer down by Fickett, and a project on Spurling. The Fickett, the Sawyer one got knocked out first. They said the road classification had changed. You're not getting it. The Shore Road one says we won't allow the money to be spent unless you built this, rebuilt Shore Road to a federal standard road. And what a federal standard road means is certain pavement widths, certain shoulder pavement widths, certain areas that then fall off to the side, you know, aprons of 4 or more feet, and that have the latitudinal and longitudinal and sight distance approach. So in other words, you know, on Shore Road, what it would mean is getting rid of the hills, getting rid of the curves, making it a sweeping, nice sweeping.
Route 77.
Like Route 77. So anything we do on Shore Road, it seems as though we're going to be doing it with local dollars if we want to improve shoulders there. Because like if you go up a bikeway, you'd have to have 8-foot bikeways on either side, plus 4 feet on beyond that on either side. So I know there's some interest, Councillor Dill has mentioned, on Shore Road. It strikes me the way to do that is locally, because you could do the 4-foot shoulders, or you could do a an off-the-road type thing without federal funds. The advantage of trying to get all this money, which is the proposal, is to shift Shore Road money to Spurwink, is that on the section of Spurwink between just below the church, and we're starting just below the church because you get out of the rules of the National Historic, that's on the National Register of Historic Places, and you don't want to do any road project within so many feet, we've discovered, of a place on the National Register. We'd like to start there, and would like to go down as far as Deer Run Road, which is, if you go past Scott Dyer Road, it's the first street on the left after Wells Road, the back end of Billy Jordan's, the Jordan family, it'll always be Billy Jordan's farm to me, the back end of the Jordan farm. And what's really nice about this is that we own more than half the land, the town, on both sides of the road. We own all of the town farmland, we own all recycling center land down by the treatment plant. So it really gives us the ability to do it. And what we'd do is go in, working with the state, and they were saying they'd do it next year if all goes well, is lift out all the pavement that's there, put something down called a foam emulsion layer, which is a bunch of materials mixed together, some new gravel and all that. Not a total reconstruction. But what end up with is the current road rebuilt, but also, interestingly enough, with 4-foot shoulders. So for those that are complaining about, you know, bicycle safety and pedestrian, this would be a real model that we could see to use, extending from Deer Run Road back to almost the church. And it also, you know, would help link with the sidewalk on Scott Dyer for those that want to do that loop. The reason we don't go beyond Deer Run is one, cost, but two, once we deal with those federal standards to get up and down those hills by Pheasant Hill and down by Papudic with the rock outcroppings, you're talking millions of dollars in order to bring that up to the standards. This seems as though, in Bob's view, my view, and also the MDOT staff we met, a reasonable way to do it. So what we're recommending is that you recommend that we apply to PACS, they still could say no, to move the Shore Road monies off over to Spurwink, and to redefine the area of Spurwink that's the project area from what was originally proposed, which was Pheasant Hill Road to the Spurwink Church intersection, to a point just northerly of the Spurwink Church to Deer Run Road. That's the recommendation. And it would provide for a built road with 4-foot shoulders.
A motion?
No, I have a question. You mentioned that there's a federal standard for the pavement width, the lane width. Is that the same as we have now?
Do you remember the exact footage? Through you, Mr. Chairman. Dave.
I believe they normally call for an 11 or 12-foot travel lane, and then they'll call for a 4-foot shoulder. As Mike said, then they have a clear zone, which is, you know, trees, any obstructions within the right-of-way have to be cleared back. So
It opens a considerable window of the road that you don't have there right now.
We would be actually, I mean, what is the pavement now?
The pavement there on Spurwink right now is probably between 22 and 24, probably closer to 24.
So they would require 24?
Yes, just in the travel lanes.
Right. And then how much shoulder? I mean, well, shoulder is the 4 feet.
Yeah, that's correct.
On both sides.
And then the apron? Yeah, both.
There may not be an apron in some places if curbing can be installed. If the curbing can't be installed, it'd be maybe a 2 foot gravel shoulder or something to accommodate some type of shoulder.
Would we?
We've had this curbing discussion with them already.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, if you think of curbs out on a rural road, I don't understand where they would be other than, say, by Colonial Village.
It would be on the section extending from just below the church to heading up towards Gullcrest, but not quite.
Down to the...
Where you have the narrower area up there is where you do it, because it also helps with the drainage and bringing it down as well.
If you put curbing in, you may not need to relocate some of the utility poles. That's another issue, is removing utility poles outside that clear zone area or back off the edge of pavement. Once they put curbing in, that changes whether they have to be moved back or not.
So we wouldn't have to, say, the site distance issue. I mean, there's some curves in there. We wouldn't have to straighten any of the road.
If we stay within this area of between the cemetery and Deer Run, we can do that. Once we move beyond that, then we get into changes in vertical, horizontal alignment. Again, as Mike said, the ledge would have to be blown, blasted. So if we can stop short of that and address that as a local project at some point, we'll be better off.
And if I might add, this is all within the right-of-way. We're not proposing to
any
right-of-way issues.
I'm just thinking, when I went down there before dark today. I mean, it seems to me we'd have to relocate a lot of ditching to make the shoulders and then make new ditching. It could be quite a change in that road. I mean, there's a lot of open area, but it that seems like considerable impact on that road. I would think, to me, I like to see us put like pedestrian shoulders on the side. I think 4 feet is more than is necessary. That used to be the federal standard, I think, for a bike path. Now we're up to 6, 8. This is the first time I've
Can we get a motion on the table? We started off with a question, okay. But let's get a motion on the table and we can continue discussion.
I would like to make a motion that we approve the PAC's reallocation from Shore Road to Spurwink as stated.
And do we have a second?
Second.
Second, Councilor Moles. Now discussion on the motion. Discussion from anyone other than Councilor Fritz. Councilor Lynch.
I just wanted to make one point clear. Yeah. We're not calling these bikeways. You noted in my memo, a bikeway would require 6 to 8 feet on either side. That's why we're not referring to those bikeways. We're only referring to those improved shoulders. So we avoid that whole mess we had a few years ago. Mm-hmm.
I think this is a good fallback plan, but it kills me that we're not going to be able to do anything on Shore Road and even on Spurwink up to Pheasant Hill, because that to me was the worst part of the road. I just want to say it strikes me that the state's approach of we're only going to use money for roads that meet federal standards is really going to penalize the smaller rural, small town communities. And I wonder if it, while we might go ahead and do what you're proposing, if it would make sense to try and get some legislation in. Have we talked to Connie Goldman? What can we do with DOT to put pressure on DOT in Augusta? Because this is a really stupid policy for a small rural state like Maine.
Unfortunately, it's federal policy. It's not state policy, and the state is just implementing it.
Okay. Stupid federal policy.
Cape Elizabeth should not be fully in the PACS area, but there are provisions in the federal law that require us to be totally within the federal urban area and become, you know, totally out for PACS. We really fall into a no-person's land as to where we want to be, you know, and regretfully, you know, I question why we spend time with PACS. You know, and the good thing about this is, you know, we look at dollars. This is 80% funded outside of Cape Elizabeth. And to be able to do this with, you know, our tax situation and, you know, with the financing plan we've developed at an 80-20 deal, I think is a good deal.
I know. It just, I think we have.